Simon & Schuster Audio presents The Age of Grievance by Frank Bruni. Read by the author.
To the many generous and wise teachers and editors in my life, anything I get right is a credit to you. What I get wrong is entirely on me. Author's note. Some of the details and language in this book appeared previously in columns and newsletters that I wrote for the New York Times. Resentment used to be something that folks wanted to get rid of. Now they water it and put it on a windowsill, like a favorite pot plant. Edward St. Aubin, Double Blind. 1. Let me tell you how I've been wronged. When I think about who we've become and where it leaves us, of the prism through which so many Americans insist on seeing the world and how it perverts their views, I flash back not to any of the biggest, strangest, and most menacing events and developments from the past few years, not to the bedlam in the halls and the blood on the floor of the U.S. Capitol, not to Paul Pelosi in his own home and in a pajama top and boxers bracing for the blow from an assailant's hammer, not to a former president essentially crowing about his unprecedented indictments in 4 criminal cases, comprising 91 felonies, and treating them as a badge of honor, but to a brief and perfectly emblematic sequence of reports on Fox News in May 2022. The United States was then suffering a shortage of baby formula, and Fox had uncovered something scandalous, something rotten. A photo told the story. "Look at that," Sean Hannity instructed his viewers as he put the image on the screen, his voice spiked with disdain. "What it showed," he said, "were pallets and pallets of baby formula for illegal immigrants and their families." The Biden administration was supposedly rerouting this precious commodity to detention centers at the country's southern border and thereby depriving hardworking American families elsewhere. Hannity seethed, or at least performed a telegenic facsimile of seething. So did Representative Kat Kamick, a Florida Republican who had furnished Fox News with this visual prop and who told Hannity that it illustrated how insane everything is right now and what a total dumpster fire the Biden administration truly is. "America last, that is what the Biden administration is all about," Kamick said. The next morning, the hosts of the winsomely alliterative, deceptively friendly-sounding Fox and Friends welcomed her on their show and echoed her disgust. The network's audience, in turn, took to social media to vent their fury. But the photo told a fable. To anyone who cared to notice and decipher the labels on the boxes in those pallets, they identify the contents as powdered milk, not the formula in short supply. It was for children well beyond their first months of life. As Alex Koppelman explained in an article on the CNN website after Hannity's snit, there is undoubtedly some formula being provided to babies in these centers at the border. You'd assume there would be, unless you expect the government to simply decide to starve babies in its care. But Hannity and company had contrived a scenario less nuanced and more politically charged than that. They'd detected a betrayal of law-abiding citizens. They'd uncovered an insidious plot. And they'd cynically and theatrically turned the thinnest possible set of facts into days of outrage over them getting something you deserve, Koppelman wrote. He called it an illuminating example of how Fox News ginned up outrage. I'd call it a defining one, but not just of Fox's business model, which would lead in April 2023 to a $787.5 million payout to Dominion Voting Systems, the largest ever publicly known amount for the settlement of a defamation lawsuit. Hannity's histrionics and his followers' freakout distilled how an enormous, perilous share of Americans had come to regard and respond to a broad range of circumstances and to their places in an addled country and agitated world. When there was trouble, when there was disappointment, when dreams were unrealized, when goals were unmet, and sometimes even when things were going perfectly well but not exactly perfectly, they looked for insult and invariably found it, even if they had to invent it. They decided that they hadn't just been unlucky, they'd been wronged. And they dwelled on that raw deal, taking its measure and assigning a particular person or people responsibility for it. They were losing because someone else was winning, or because some corrupt overlord had rigged everything against them. The blame game was America's most popular sport, and victimhood its most fashionable garb. Around the same time that many Americans decided that the Biden administration was starving babies, they decided, too, that it was poisoning adults. J.D. Vance, a Republican running in Ohio for an open Senate seat, gave voice to this paranoia, suggesting as much in an interview with a right-wing news outlet, of sorts, the Gateway Pundit. He traced the drug overdose deaths so prevalent in certain parts of the country, including the Appalachian tracks that he'd written about in his best-selling memoir, Hillbilly Elegy, to the illegal border crossings that the Biden administration was failing to prevent. If you wanted to kill a bunch of MAGA voters in the middle of the heartland, how better than to target them and their kids with this deadly fentanyl, Vance said. He added that, "It does look intentional. It's like Joe Biden wants to punish the people who didn't vote for him, and opening up the floodgates to the border is one way to do it." It was a cockamamie analysis for many reasons, including these: illegal border crossings, seizures of fentanyl at the border, and deaths related to fentanyl in the United States had risen during Trump's presidency before they rose further still during Biden's. And the deaths that had gone up most since Biden's inauguration were among black men, who, as a group, tended to vote for Democrats over Republicans by enormous margins. But Vance's imagining of a dastardly scheme worked the same emotional levers that almost every hour of programming on Fox News did. It exposed an outrage, identified the wounded parties, and validated their sense that there were forces, sometimes specific and nameable, other times shapeless, but just as sinister, arrayed against them. It gave them and people around them permission to be angry, and anger had become the primary driver of much of American discourse and most of American politics. It had particularly ugly contours and consequences on the political right. That was where conspiracy theories such as QAnon thrived, and conspiracy theorists such as Marjorie Taylor Greene prospered. It was the staging ground for the fatal breaching of the U.S. Capitol by the frenzied invaders who turned January 6, 2021, into a bloody grievance prom. And it was the truest home and most fertile territory for Donald Trump, who, like every president before him, personified key aspects of his era and served as a kind of tuning fork for its temper. He became a victor by playing the victim, and his most impassioned oratory, such as it was, focused not on the good that he could do for others, but on the bad supposedly done to him, by the media, by snooty liberals, by devious and election-stealing Democrats, by the Republicans who initially resisted him and then surrendered to him, by the FBI in general, by James Comey in particular, by the rest of the deep state. The culprits were countless, and their offenses infinite. Not even Richard Nixon had made claims of persecution such a central part of his political identity, at least not until the final days. What an extraordinary and oxymoronic pose Trump struck, bemoaning his impotence amid proclamations of superpotency, demanding pity as he flew in his private jet to his gilded mansions with their fastidiously groomed golf courses. Preposterously but cunningly, he cast himself as both martyr and messiah, braving and transcending the condescension to which his supporters were also subjected and redeeming them in the process. He vowed to have the last laugh on all the people who'd ever laughed at him, and many Americans thrilled to that. It suited their spite. He was grudge made flesh, grievance become president. But he had no monopoly on grievance, just as Fox News wasn't its sole marketplace. Before, during, and after Trump's presidency, grievance was everywhere you looked and in most, if not many, of the loudest voices you heard. The American soundtrack has become a cacophony of competing complaints. Some are righteous, and others specious. Some are urgent and others frivolous. Those distinctions are too often lost on the complainers. How they feel is all that matters. It's their greatest truth, and they feel cheated. They feel disrespected. They're peeved unless they're outright furious, and that ire is neither confined to nor concentrated in any one race, any one region, any one political party, any one class, any one faith, any one gender, any one profession. It flares even where that makes the least sense. It burns at the very pinnacles of privilege. The Supreme Court, for supreme example. It was once one of the most respected institutions in the United States. A panel of us.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.